I see them at Christmas time, out ringing the bells. I've seen their bands playing at the mall and those angel trees.
The bell, the ringing of the bell.
I think those bell ringers are all around the world.
I really don't have many thoughts upon their contribution to society.
Oh yeah, they're those people with the ringing the bells outside of Walmart during Christmas.
I guess after they collect that money, it goes to different community service programs, although I don't exactly know what they're for.
Trucks passing, Salvation Army, trucks.
I would think historically of the uniform, although I believe they're not using that anymore.
Don't they ring the bells at Christmas time?
I really don't know what the Salvation Army is. I reckon they kind of recycle old clothes and furniture and stuff.
I guess the thing it's most known for among people my age group, at least, is the thrift shops.
I think of a church. It's a church.
Oh, how old the army is. Judging by the uniforms of the guy out in front of my grocery store, I would say at least the 50s.
The bell ringers in front of the store.
The Red Cross.
The bells with money in them. The big ball with money in there.
It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. It was the age of wisdom, it was the age of foolishness. It was the epoch of belief, it was the epoch of incredulity. It was the season of light, it was the season of darkness. It was the spring of hope, it was the winter of despair. And in the empire of the young Queen Victoria, in the dank and putrid world of industrial England, the story of the Salvation Army begins. It begins with a boy, tall, stoop-shouldered pawnbroker's apprentice, a character worthy of Charles Dickens, the great author of the day. The story of the Salvation Army begins within the heart of William Booth. At 13 years of age, William had been taken out of school and apprenticed to a pawnbroker. His father, an illiterate housebuilder, impoverished himself and died, leaving the family penniless. Desperately poor himself, William had to deal with the desperate poverty of others. Under the sign of the pawnbroker, he learned more than the pricing of cotton umbrellas or the deft handling of pawn tickets. He learned, as from a primer, what poverty did to people. Families appeared before this boy to pledge their worn and dwindling possessions, pitiful little trinkets. Sunday silk handkerchiefs went first to the counter. Wedding rings came last. Over and over, his mother would say to him,
"Be good, William, and then all will be well."
But how was he to be good? The Church of England, where he had been baptized, was a cold and formal place, a place where the rich had their allotted pews, and the poor were not welcome. John Wesley, the giant reformer of religion in England, had been dead some 40 years. His followers had broken away from the Church of England and formed separate sects.
When, as a giddy youth of 15, I was led to attend Wesley Chapel, Nottingham, I felt that I wanted, in place of the life of self-indulgence to which I was yielding myself, a happy, conscious sense that I was pleasing God, living right, and spending all my powers to get others into such a life. The condition of the suffering people around me affected me very deeply. There were children crying for bread to parents whose own distress was little less terrible.
In the 18th century, John Wesley sought to reclaim men without God, the downtrodden and the desperate who cursed life itself. This fragile little minister, educated at Oxford, took the radical step of preaching in the open air to crowds of drunken miners, a pile of stones as his pulpit.
I thought that there was one God, that John Wesley was his prophet, and that the Methodists were his special people.
In a schoolroom of the Wesleyan Chapel was a plain wooden table, and at that table, people were kneeling, confessing their sins, and surrendering their lives to God. The boy knelt at their side.
I made up my mind that God Almighty should have all their woes of William Booth.
I heard the first sermon he ever preached. It was in a small cottage in Kidd Street. He had come straight from work. There was a box placed upside down on the table for a desk, with a candle and a Bible. Poor women came into the parlour, bringing their own chairs with them. Some men stood in the doorway, afraid to come in lest they be converted. Will Booth's sermon, oh, how well I remember it. It was very gentle and tender, and so strange for a young man to preach that it almost made some of the women smile. He talked of little children learning to walk, how they toddled and swayed and came near to falling. He said how difficult a thing it was to learn to trust their tiny feet and advance with courage. Then he said it was just as difficult to lead a true Christian life, and that we should be on the lookout for helping people, especially those who are just beginning to live that life. Hard words would not help them, sitting still would not help them. We must go and do something to make it less hard for them to walk straight. I heard a very different sermon in Red Lion Square. I remember how he called out in his great voice.
Friends, I want to put a few straight questions to your souls. Have any of you got a child at home without shoes to its little feet? Are your wives sitting now in dark houses, waiting for you to return without money? Are you going away from here to the public houses to spend on drink, money that your wives need for food, and your children for food?
It was all like that. I think there had never been such preaching in the open streets before.
After 6 years, his apprenticeship ended. Unable to find work, he moved to London, where he was desperately lonely, and the only job to be found was in a pawn shop. He settled above the shop, and soon after, he sought opportunities to preach in the nearby Wesleyan Chapel. His zeal was not always appreciated, but Edward Rabbits, a wealthy boot manufacturer, heard him preach and was so impressed, he offered to support William for 3 months if he would devote himself solely to preaching. On Good Friday, April 10th, 1851, his 23rd birthday, William accompanied Mr. Rabbits to a service in a schoolroom. There, he fell in love with Catherine Mumford. After the meeting, Booth escorted Miss Mumford to her home by hackney coach.
That little journey will never be forgotten by either of us. He impressed me, and we struck in at once in such a wonderful harmony of view and aim and feeling that it seemed as though we had intimately known and loved each other for years. Before we reached my home, we both suspected, we felt as though we had been made for each other, and that henceforth the current of our lives must flow together.
Catherine Mumford, 4 months older than William, was the only daughter, while three of her four brothers died as infants. Semi-invalid due to a spinal defect, Catherine absorbed education in solitude, reading and forming her own judgments. The Bible was her earliest lesson book. Before she was 12, she had read it from cover to cover 8 times. Her likes and dislikes were equally strong. She hated worldliness, cruelty, and intoxicants. She loved animals, the truth, and the downtrodden. The earliest desire of these two young people not to allow any thought of their own happiness to interfere with their duty to God delayed their marriage for 3 years. William accepted an invitation to become circuit minister in an area that spread 30 miles. Catherine's letters sustained him.
My dearest William, your desire is to do the will of God, and He will guide you. Never mind who frowns, if God smiles.
My own dear Catherine, I feel uncommonly tired and weary this morning. My head aches, and I feel altogether out of order. I walked home from Greenwich last night. I ought to have ridden.
My dearest love, I have read your letter again since writing the enclosed, and have opened the envelope to send you another line. Don't sit up singing till 12 o'clock after a hard day's work. Such things are not required by either God or man. And remember, you are not your own.
My dearest Kate, I want a sermon on the flood, one on Jonah, and one on the judgment. Nothing moves people like the terrific.
On one subject, there was a sharp difference of opinion.
I would not encourage a woman to begin preaching, although I would not stop her on any account.
Oh, prejudice, what it will not do. That woman is in any respect except physical strength and courage inferior to man, I cannot see cause to believe. And I'm sure no one can prove it from the word of God.
I am for the world's salvation. I will quarrel with no means that promises help.
On June 16th, 1855, they were married. After 1 week's honeymoon, they began a whirlwind tour of Lincoln, Bristol, Bradford, Manchester, Sheffield. Within months, all these cities felt the cyclone impact of Booth's personality. The first three of their eight children were born in different towns. In Gateshead, a town nicknamed the Converting Shop due to the impact of William, Catherine began working with alcoholic men. Within a few weeks, 10 of these men had turned away from drinking and met her each week for Bible reading and prayer. Catherine was a very liberated woman for her time, so when she heard an inner voice telling her to preach, she knew God was speaking to her. With great fear and trepidation, she acted on it and found that William and the Gateshead congregation welcomed her preaching enthusiastically. It was the first sultry week of July, and Booth was invited to preach in a tent in the old burying ground in Whitechapel. For all the crusading years of his life, he had sought a human jungle. Now he walked in its midst. London's 100,000 pubs laid end to end would have stretched a full 30 miles. In East London, every fifth shop was a gin shop. Beer shops were open 18 hours a day. A man could become drunk for a penny. For liquor, parents neglected their children. Girls sold their virtue. Men became criminals. He saw five-year-olds blind drunk in doorways. William Booth did not look upon the wretched scene of his day as a social worker might today. Only, and always, he saw the salvation of the soul as the answer to man's need. If a man righted himself with God, all would be well.
When I saw those masses of poor people, so many of them without God or hope in the world, my heart went out to them. I walked back to our West End home and said to my wife, "Oh, Kate, I found my destiny. These are the people for whose salvation I've been longing all these years."
I remember the emotion this produced in my soul. I sat gazing at the fire, and the devil whispered to me, "This means another departure, another start in life." After a momentary pause for thought and prayer, I replied, "Well, if you feel you ought to stay, stay. We have trusted in the Lord once for our support, and we can trust him again."
That night, the Salvation Army was born. The Whitechapel experience was like preaching in hell, for the atheism of East London was fierce, an atheism that hated the very name of God.
Mr. Booth, he shouted at them finally, and then he gave out a hymn and led the singing until he just drowned out their noise. It seemed as if he'd tear the soul right out of your body. And then in the midst of it all, there'd be a bit that would make you want to cry, or a tale that would set you laughing fit to burst. But all the time you felt he wanted to save your soul, there was no mistake about that.
He began his preaching in the open air, on the long strip of pavement called the Mile End Waste. In all sorts of weather, this tall stranger talked about their souls. After 12 months of unflagging work, his converts tallied only 60. But the work went on. Wealthy philanthropists came staunchly to the rescue. Samuel Morley, a manufacturer, wrote a check as his first annual contribution and asked his friends, a bacon merchant, an Edinburgh tea merchant, and two brothers who were Cardiff ship owners, to do the same. Professor Orson's dancing academy was secured for indoor services. The East London Christian Mission, as they were now called, met in a stable, an old beer house, a lime house, and a wool warehouse.
The windows opened onto the street, and if we opened them, boys threw stones and fireworks through. But our people got used to this, shouting hallelujah when the crackers exploded.
Like his hero John Wesley, he saw himself as a link between the churches and the unchurched.
My first thought was to constitute an evangelistic agency, the converts going to the churches. But to this there were three main obstacles. First, they would not go where they were sent. Second, they were not wanted when they did go. Third, I soon found I wanted them myself.
They put me to work right away. We had open-air meetings, and I remember having to stand conspicuously in my own street. They also gave me sick visiting to do.
William and Catherine could not ignore the physical needs of the people they encountered each day. The mission's first report of 1867 shows how they responded. 16-year-old Bramwell Booth, the eldest, ran a small chain of Food for the Millions shops, which gave the poor hot soup at all hours and three-course dinners for sixpence. These were revolutionary activities at their time and came about as a compassionate response to people in need. Not a religion of stained glass windows and the music of Bach, but of soap and a square meal with noise, cheerful songs, and everyone so busy they could not be bored.
Hello, hello, hello. Some people go for funny drinks and down and by the pail, like coffee, cocoa, tea or milk, or even Adam's ale. For my part, you can keep the lot. I never would complain. I never touch the blooming stuff. I only drink champagne. For Champagne Charlie is me name.
Booth hired the Effingham Theatre on Sunday evenings and advertised for 3,000 people to come and fill it. Crowds of idle and dissolute characters filled the theater, but he held their attention. And then Booth and his early Salvationists did more than take over the actual theater. They took over the music as well. Booth felt that if a man was happy and he had discovered his savior, then why not use a tune that everybody knew to let everyone know? So Champagne Charlie became this.
Bless his name, he sets me free. Bless his name, he sets me free. Oh, the blood, the precious blood, I'm trusting in the cleansing flood. Bless his name, he sets me free. Bless his name, he sets me free. I know the past is washed away, and now in Jesus I am free. In Jesus I am free, I'm free.
Over 80 music hall songs acquired religious lyrics, and Booth declared, why should the devil have all the best tunes? From the first, the entire family was in the thick of it. With infinite care, the children were fitted to life, not with the ministry, but into it.
Our mother used to patch our clothes and make us proud of the patches.
Until the mission was 2 years old, Catherine held her own series of evangelistic meetings, exclusively in the West End, and raised great sums of money for the work.
When we were little, there were those who condoled with us because we saw so little of our mother. It was so unusual for a woman to go onto the public platform that her work was not understood. We really saw more of our mother than did those children whose mothers were society women who went on the rounds of endless calls, attended balls and receptions. We were impressed by her example and tried to be like her.
I remember the first Christmas day I spent in their home. The general determined that his children should have a thoroughly old-fashioned Christmas. The children were full of excitement, and I really thought it would be a day of the purest happiness. But when the general returned from preaching in Whitechapel on Christmas morning, he looked dreadfully white and drawn, as if he had some grievous worry. Oh, he did his best to enter into the fun and frolic, but it was no use. He kept relapsing into silence and gloom. And suddenly he burst out, I'll never have a Christmas like this again. He paced up and down like a caged lion, telling us the sights he'd seen that morning at Whitechapel. The poor have nothing but the public house. Sights that other people would see, feel sorry for and forget, would stab him to the heart. Other people would see only the drinking. He saw the poverty, the misery, the disease. The sins of London didn't shock him. They seemed to tear at his heart with claws that drew blood.
True to his word, that Christmas Day was the last one the Booth family ever spent together. The next Christmas, Bramwell and the others ranged the slums distributing plum puddings cooked in the Booth kitchen. It was a foreshadowing of the millions of Christmas dinners the army would later distribute in the Whitechapels of the world. Booth's movement had been growing more quickly than even he had intended. Weekly operating costs, which in 1870 were £50 a week, grew so fast that in 10 years, the poor alone contributed £14,500 weekly. Booth had done the directing, recording, and bookkeeping, with Bramwell as his aide. Organized help was needed.
We had to build the ship while we're at sea, and not only build the ship, but master the laws of navigation.
George Scott Railton was 24 years old when he arrived to take up his position as secretary to Booth. Railton was a lovable eccentric, capable of laughing until the tears ran down his face. Indifferent to sacrifice, he would preach until he was hoarse and pray until his knees were petrified. In 1878, William, Bramwell, and Railton were checking an article for the Christian Mission's annual report. The Christian Mission, it said, is a volunteer army. Bramwell interrupted to say, I'm not a volunteer, I'm a regular or nothing. William stopped short, thought hard for a moment, and seized his pen. He crossed out volunteer and wrote salvation. The idea caught on like wildfire. Uniforms were adopted. Members became soldiers. Soldiers fired cartridges at their weekly donations. Evangelists were captains and majors serving in local corps and working from a citadel. Salvationists did not die. They were promoted to glory. And William Booth was no longer general superintendent, but the general of the Salvation Army. The new army found its way across the sea when Amos Shirley, with his wife and 16-year-old daughter, Eliza, Salvationist from Coventry, England, settled in Philadelphia and opened fire in an abandoned chair factory. Eliza wrote the general of their work and asked him to send reinforcements.
Dear Eliza, if you're determined to start a religious work in America, you will do well to organize it along the line of the army. If you do this, you have my permission to call it the Salvation Army. General William Booth.
It's 1880, just 15 years after the Salvation Army's birth. New York newspapers recorded the arrival of a young man in full military uniform, accompanied by what were described as seven hallelujah lassies. His name was George Scott Railton, and he claimed to have orders from General William Booth of the Salvation Army to begin the Army's work in the United States. Near the docks in Battery Park, Railton and the seven lassies attracted considerable attention with their singing and their preaching. He claimed he was ordered to wage war against evil and despair, and then he marched all who would follow to Mrs. Doolittle's Five Points mission.
In the summer of 1880, as the Army's first commissioner, Railton traveled 4,200 miles in 49 days, delivering 80 messages. In the fall, he moved national headquarters, which was only a few papers, a table, a chair, and a bedstead in the basement, to St. Louis, Missouri. In St. Louis, he issued the first war cry. Commissioner Railton strongly believed that any expansion of the work must come from new converts recruited from within the countries invaded. The general ordered him home a year later because in Britain, in the early 1880s, the opposition was fierce. Salvationists had campaigned hard against excessive drinking, and many pubs came close to ruin as heavy drinkers turned to God. A skeleton army was organized to disrupt open-air meetings, and Salvationists were pelted with rotten food, mud, and stones. Riots erupted, and Salvationists came off badly in court as well as on the street. But persecution did bring one tremendous and unexpected benefit. Just outside Salisbury, in a cottage, lived a builder named Charles Fry. He had three grown sons, Fred, Ernest, and Bertram.
Wait, Bertram, you got a pause there?
Pause, yeah.
Yeah, you all got a pause. Same time, right. And we'll try that again. From the top, this time, watch me on the pause, right? One, two, two, two.
In the evening, when the work was done, they played music together. The Fries were staunch Methodists who heard that hooligans were roughing up local street meetings. What was needed was a bodyguard. And while they were there, they might as well bring along their instruments. And so the first Salvation Army band was born.
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing door? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully...
Tambourine sales skyrocketed. The Fries gave up their business to start the Army's musical department. The first year, there were 400 Salvation Army bands. But life in the Booth home had taken a grim turn. Catherine was terminally ill with cancer.
I shall never forget, in this world or the next, that meeting. I'd been watching for the cab and had run to meet her and help her up the steps. She tried to smile through her tears, but drawing me into the room, she told me the verdict of the doctors. I sat down, speechless. She knelt beside me and said to me, "Do you know what my first thought was? That I should not be there to nurse you at your last hour."
She died at age 61, surrounded by her family. There was great sadness at her death. Catherine Booth was publicly acknowledged as one of the most remarkable women of the 19th century. Besieged by more homeless and hungry people than the army could cope with, to earn money, William had begun writing a book about the situation in what he called Darkest England. Shortly after Catherine's death, he finished his book, In Darkest England and the Way Out, in which he poured out his feelings. He wrote passionately about the submerged tenth of the population, the poor, who had no rights.
When in the streets of London, a cab horse, weary or careless or stupid, trips and falls and lies stretched out in the midst of the traffic. There's no question of debating how he came to stumble before we try to get him on his feet again. The cab horse is a real illustration of poor, broken down humanity. These are the two points in the cab horse's charter. When he's down, he's to be helped up. And while he lives, he has food, shelter, and work.
He devised a social scheme which would offer food and shelter for the homeless and provide them with work and training for work. He wanted to see them become self-supporting and self-respecting. The book was a huge bestseller, and William Booth became the most talked about man in Britain as people began to grasp what he was saying. In the play Major Barbara, George Bernard Shaw criticized the army for using tainted money to do its work. To this, Booth answered,
"We will wash it in the tears of the widows and orphans and lay it on the altar of humanity."
William never got over Catherine's death, but for the remaining 22 years of his life, he threw himself into his work. Always an innovator, he used the most modern technology available to him.
reach and gather these, I must make a big sound and paint with a big brush, big as the stars. Some of you men never pray. You gave up praying long ago. But I'm going to say to you, won't you pray for your children, that they may be different?
A further blow was to fall upon him. His second daughter, Emma, who was serving as joint leader with her husband in the United States, was killed in a train wreck. In her last letter to her father, she wrote,
"My precious General, I am still on the wing. We were in St. Louis on Sunday, where we had, in some respects, a rather remarkable day. The entire feeling of the city is distinctly different since your visit. The sympathy is most marked. I spoke for 15 minutes in the Merchants' Exchange, a huge marble structure. No woman, they say, has ever been heard there before. This was Saturday noon, and quite a number of the leading businessmen turned up at Sunday's meeting. Can't write more. How I wonder how you are. Up above us all so high, like a diamond in the sky. Though perhaps I ought to say a cyclone or a racehorse or... but there is no simile fine enough. Good night. Would that you were here so that I could say it and hear all that you would like to say and then start off again to try and carry out your wishes with better success. As your unfailing Emma."
Shortly after Emma's death, her younger sister, Evangeline, was appointed to succeed as national commander in America. In the United States, women did not as yet have the right to vote. But Eva led an army of men and women expected to follow her orders. Determined to do something about the appalling poverty and degradation of New York's Lower East Side, Eva sent slum sisters to live among the people. They spent their days doing what needed to be done, ready to scrub, drive out the rats, tend a jaundiced woman, deal with a drunken father.
"We didn't even carry a handkerchief. That would have alienated us."
"Where police must go in pairs, we go unharmed. Hands begrimed with dirt or stained with human blood are stretched out to bid us welcome."
Christianity, with its sleeves rolled up, is the way American poet Basho Lindsay described what he saw of the Army's work.
Eva spends it all, the New York Headlines trumpet in April of 1906. The infant Christmas present to Catherine and William Booth is now the national commander of the Salvation Army in America. San Francisco has just experienced a deadly earthquake and fire which ravaged the entire city with death and destruction everywhere. The commander, as she liked to be called, took more than $4 million, the Army's entire available resource for 1906, to the devastated city and spent it in relief of human suffering and pain. When challenged by the press, all she replied was, "God will provide." The record reveals he did.
On the 20th of August, 1912, William Booth, God's soldier, laid down his sword. He lay in state in the Congress Hall, London. Thousands came to pay tribute. For the last time, he leaves the Army headquarters in Queen Victoria Street. Through the streets of London, his funeral procession passed, through the city of which he was freeman. The flags of nations invaded by the Army were carried proudly at the head of the column. The whole traffic of this metropolis was arrested by one of the densest multitudes that ever thronged its thoroughfares. As the carriage passed the Mansion House, the Lord Mayor of London saluted the coffin. 10,000 men and women from the ranks of the Salvation Army, specially selected to represent their comrades, walked behind their promoted leader, who had taught them to give their lives ministering to the poorest, the lowliest, and the lost.
In 60 years as an evangelist, William Booth had preached 60,000 sermons and had drawn 16,000 officers to follow the flag in 58 countries, preaching the gospel in 34 languages.
In 1912, as William Booth passed into glory, the world stood poised on the brink of war. World War I began in 1914, and by 1917, the United States was part of it. Eva, ever the national commander, won General John J. Pershing's approval and sent young men and women with the troops into the lines, bringing food and care and a touch of home. The donut girls of World War I seem elevated in myth, but history proves the reality of their courage.
We helped to give the soldiers their first aid until they could be sent to base hospitals. There were long trenches dug each day to bury the boys who died during the night. There was no chaplain, so we would repeat a psalm, say a prayer, sing a hymn, and weep. I have written many a letter to a soldier's mother, who otherwise would never have known that someone had done what they could.
I've done my bit for Uncle Sam, 3,000 miles away. I've had my fill of fighting, and I'm home this time to stay. I think they'd have to drag me in for another such a whirl. But I'd wade through hell barefooted for the little donut girl.
Before, it was the drunk, the bum, the parolee who had come for the handout. Now, the line would be lengthened block after block by every man. The Great Depression reduced the Army's contributions while increasing its social rescue work by 700%. Evangeline Booth served for 30 years as the national commander in the United States. Like her father, she was a dramatic presence with immense platform power. It was said that everything she touched in the Salvation War flourished. She was elected the fourth general of the Salvation Army. Mayor LaGuardia held a ticker tape parade for the general of what he called the greatest, most useful army in the whole world. In the words of General Evangeline Booth,
"The Salvation Army is the greatest romance in the world, an impossible dream come true. It was started by my parents, William and Catherine Booth, a procession of two along an East London street that grew into a global army of tens of hundreds of thousands. It was founded in Australia by a minuteman and a bricklayer. It was begun in Canada by one man raising the blood and fire flag of the Salvationists in Toronto. And it was started in the United States by a little girl of 16 in a stable in Philadelphia. You ask, what is the secret of the Salvation Army's achievement for the world's good? From whence its power? The power is our faith in the gospel we preach. We preach God is. We preach with a cheerful spirit and a loving heart and a helping hand. We preach in song and teaching, in word and in deed. We preach to the white, the black, the red, the bronze, the yellow, all God's children. We preach God's love. The work of the Salvation Army is an extraordinary romance. A circle of light around a London lamppost that expanded until now it encircles the world.
And what of the Salvation Army today?
The world's not really changed all that much, has it? If you feel that William Booth felt a special calling to go towards those with problems with addiction, alcohol, drugs, gambling, and anything that enslaves human beings, well, really, nothing much has changed in that respect. I'm one of the great-great-grandchildren of William and Catherine Booth. I think in many conversations I've had with people, someone will suddenly say, well, what would the founder say? And that's quite interesting. Would he be pleased with the kind of Salvation Army we have nowadays? I have a feeling his very nature was always demanding more, demanding better. I mean, the way he would say to Brummell, go and do something, as if Brummell wasn't doing anything at the time. He certainly would have that same approach. Okay, boys, you're doing something. Girls, you're doing something great there. But there's a lot more that can be done. You read a biography of William Booth and Catherine, and you're just surprised how quick he was at picking up new trends, new ideas, and just putting them into practice. If he felt there was a way to use it to communicate the gospel, well, he was going for it. And I think in a way he would be excited to think, I mean, nearly every year there's something new coming out, new ways, new technological means. He might just say, hey, you know, why are you putting the foot on the brake? There's so much at your disposal. Go for it. I could imagine he'd put in his name for a flight to the moon just to make sure that the Salvation Army was on television, you know, saying that the Salvation Army has been on the moon too.
I am the Salvation Army.
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 I am Salvation Army.
I am the 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 Salvation Army.
I am Salvation Army.
I am Salvation Army.
I am the Salvation Army.
I am the Salvation Army.